Hello everyone, I am Dr. Vaishnavi. Today I am going to talk about tuning fork test. I hope you are able to listen to me and see to me. So the topic for discussion is tuning fork tests. This is one of the most important topics in your exams, and most often I've seen students making mistakes on this topic. So that is why I chose that I will do tuning fork test today, so that you have a clear idea on this topic per se, and you're able to answer any MCQs. So I will be teaching you the basic concept. If you know the principle of tuning fork test, then to answer any MCQs is like a cakewalk. If you do not know the principle, then it becomes extremely difficult. So in tuning fork test, there is no chance of mugging or memory or whatsoever. It's only your concept that will take you forward. Okay, so we will start a tuning fork test. So what is the frequency of normal hearing? Humans can hear which frequency sounds? So humans can hear the sounds which lie between 20 to 20,000 hertz. This is the first thing that you need to know. What is the normal ear perception? What we can hear the best? We can hear the best when the sound range falls between 20 to 20,000 hertz. But are we testing all these frequencies in an audiometry? No. We don't test all these frequencies in an audiometry. We test only the speech frequencies which lie between 250 hertz to 8000 hertz. So only this is tested in an audiometry. The next thing, what are the types of hearing loss? We've got three types of hearing loss, which could be conductive, which could be sensory neural, or mixed. What is the meaning of conductive? So we know this is your pinna, external auditory canal, tympanic membrane, middle ear, and inner ear. In the middle ear, we have malleus, incus, and the stapes. Okay, so if there is any pathology from your pinna till your foot plate of the stapes, we call it as a conductive hearing loss. Any pathology behind the cochlea, so from the foot plate of the stapes till the central auditory pathway, that is till your brain, is your sensory neural hearing loss. So we subdivide it into cochlear and retrocochlear, but for now we have got two types, a conductive hearing loss and a sensory neural hearing loss. And if there is a combination of both conductive hearing loss with sensory neural hearing loss, we call it as a mixed hearing loss. Now, what tuning fork do we commonly use? We use a 512 hertz tuning fork. What is the reason why we use a 512 hertz tuning fork? Because if you use a fork of lower frequency, it will give you a false sense of bone vibration. Whereas if you use a higher frequency, the vibration of the tuning fork will last only for a shorter time, meaning that there is a shorter decay time for the tuning fork. As a result, the patient will not be able to appreciate that change in sound. So lesser is used, not used because of false sense of bone vibration. A higher tone frequency is not used because you are going to get a shorter decay time, meaning the tuning fork's vibration will decay faster. Now, to test air conduction, how are you going to test the air conduction? If this is your pinna, this is your external auditory canal, tympanic membrane, middle ear, inner ear, and this is your E. coli path, malleus, incus, and the stapes. Now, to test the air conduction, you will put a tuning fork 2 centimeters away from the pinna. So you vibrate a tuning fork, you keep the tuning fork 2 centimeters away from the pinna. Okay, and now what happens? The sound vibrations are traveling from your external ear to your tympanic membrane, from your tympanic membrane to your middle ear, from your middle ear to your inner ear. Okay, so the pathway of the sound is from the external ear to your middle ear to your inner ear and your central auditory pathway. So what does your air conduction measure? So your air conduction measures your conductive pathway, which is from your pinna till the foot plate of the stapes. It also measures your sensory neural pathway, which is from your inner ear to your central auditory system. So if you do not know this concept, what is AC, what is BC, you cannot do any tuning fork test. So AC is equal to conductive pathway plus sensory neural pathway, because the sound is traveling through the conductive route as well as the sensory neural route. If you have any doubts while I'm taking the class, please put it in the comment section below so that I will be able to help you there. If you want me to repeat any part per se, I can do it. So you can put the put your doubts or your comments or anything that you feel is difficult, you can put it down. I will be able to help you there. Okay, so I hope you got what is AC. Now, what is BC? What is bone conduction? So bone conduction, you vibrate a tuning fork and you place it over the mastoid process. Now, what happens when you put it on the mastoid process? The sound is now going to be transmitted directly to the cochlea. It is bypassing your external ear and your middle ear. So since the sound is going directly to your cochlea, it measures only your sensory neural pathway. So you always should know this formula. AC is equal to conductive pathway plus sensory neural pathway. BC is equal to only sensory neural pathway. Okay? If this is clear, we will move there. So AC is a test of conductive pathway plus sensory neural pathway. BC is equal to only sensory neural pathway. Now, when we compare AC versus BC, which one should be louder and longer? Which path is a longer path? It's your AC path. Which path is a shorter path? BC path. Now, where is the sound heard the best, the loudest, in air or in bone? So it is heard the best in the air. So air conduction is louder and longer than the bone conduction. So AC is greater than BC. This is the principle of a test, which we call it as a Rinne's test. Okay. So in Rinne's test, AC is greater than BC. What do you mean by AC is greater than BC? Air conduction is louder and longer than the bone conduction. When will you see this AC is greater than BC? That we will come there. But for now, tell me, if AC is equal to conductive pathway plus sensory neural pathway, BC is equal to only sensory neural pathway. If I have a conductive pathology, say I have got a wax in my ear, I have got a tympanic membrane perforation, or I have got a middle ear effusion. Now, which will get affected? Is only AC getting affected, or only BC getting affected, or both AC and BC getting affected? Jyotsna Gupta, you're asking for throat part, ma'am. I did not get you, Jyotsna. Can you please clarify in detail what you want? Meanwhile, if there is a conductive pathway problem, AC is affected, because in BC does not measure your conductive pathology problem. So only AC is affected in conductive pathway pathology. Whereas in sensory neural pathology, your AC as well as BC gets affected. So when will AC be lesser than BC? Whenever you have got a conductive pathology or a conductive pathway problem. But AC is greater than BC in normal and sensory neural hearing loss. Even when there is a sensory neural pathology, AC is affected, BC is affected, still AC is better than BC. So Rinne's is divided into positive or negative. Whenever you get a question in your exam, say HIV positive, HBsAg positive, HCV positive, dengue IgM positive, it means that the person is having a disease. But Rinne positive is not a disease. Rinne positive is normal. This is how you're going to remember. Most often students get confused in the exams, thinking that Rinne positive means there is some pathology. There is no pathology. Rinne positive is normal. Okay, so Rinne positive is seen in normal and SNHL. So Rinne positive means AC is greater than BC, which is seen in normally as well as sensory neural hearing loss. Rinne negative is seen in conductive hearing loss, where BC is greater than AC. Okay, so I hope you understood what is a Rinne's test. Okay. So Rinne's test positive is AC greater than BC seen in normal and SNHL. Negative is seen is conductive hearing loss. Okay, so this you need to know. Jyotsna Gupta, yes, I will take diseases and anatomy, not an issue. In the next YouTube class, maybe I will fulfill your request. Fine. The next test is your Weber's test. So in your Weber's test, what are you going to do if you assume this is your face? This is your external auditory canal, pinna, middle ear and your inner ear. Now, what are you doing in this Weber's test? You're vibrating a tuning fork and you're placing into the glabella or onto the vertex or at the level of nasion, anywhere in the midline. You can also use the inter incisors. Anywhere in the midline, you take a tuning fork, vibrate it and put it in the midline. Now, what happens when you place the tuning fork in the midline? The sounds are being conducted through your bone. So, when sounds are being conducted through your bone, what is happening? The sound is reaching to your cochlea because we know it bypasses your external ear and your middle ear. Bone conduction is bypasses external ear and middle ear and goes directly to the cochlea. So what is right cochlea doing? It is trying to pull the sounds towards the right side. What is the left cochlea doing? It's trying to pull the sounds towards the left side. As a result, equal distribution of sound happens into both the ears. This is normal. So what is Weber's normal? Equal lateralization of sounds to the both cochlea, because both the cochlea are functioning well, both are trying to pull the sound towards each side. So you are going to have an equal distribution of sounds onto both the sides. The next thing, what happens in conductive hearing loss? Assume that I am having a pathology in my conductive pathway. Now, as a compensatory mechanism, see, whenever you have a defect in one part of your pathway, the other part becomes hypersensitive. So, since there is a conductive pathway problem here, this cochlea becomes hypersensitive to sound because it wants to attract more sounds towards it because your conductive pathway is not functioning. As a result, the sound will go more towards the affected side. So, in a conductive pathology, the sounds will get lateralized towards the affected ear. Okay, this is your affected ear. The sounds will go towards that side. So, normal is equal on both the sides. In conductive pathology, it gets lateralized to the affected ear. Hemant, I will tell you about false negative Rinne with an MCQ, which I have it in the end. Jyotsna, yes, I will come to my next video when and what time it will be. Just give me some time. Okay, so in the conductive pathway, it goes toward conductive pathology, it goes towards the affected ear. In your sensory neural pathology, the sound gets lateralized towards the opposite ear, meaning if my right cochlea is damaged, what will happen? The opposite cochlea is trying to pull the sound towards that ear. So your sounds will get lateralized towards the opposite ear if you have a sensory neural pathway problem. So SNP towards the opposite side. Is it clear to all of you? Yes, have you understood about the Weber's test? Normally, both the cochlea are sensory receptors. They want to pull the sound towards their side. If there is a conductive pathology on my right side, the cochlea becomes more sensitive to sounds. As a result, it is trying to pull the sounds towards its side. In conductive pathology, the sound goes towards the affected side. In sensory neural pathology, the sound goes towards the opposite side because this cochlea is not functioning. It is deaf. As a result, the sound is being pulled by the opposite cochlea. As a result, the sound gets lateralized towards the opposite side. Yes. So if you have understood this, we will go next to the absolute bone conduction test. So with Rinne, you will know what is the pathology. You probably have an idea. With Weber also, you get an idea. But to confirm a sensory neural pathology, you do this absolute bone conduction test. What is the meaning of absolute bone conduction? You are putting the tuning fork on the mastoid and you want only the bone conduction route to function. You do not want the air conduction route to function, because when you put a tuning fork on the mastoid, some of the sound waves can go through your external auditory canal to your through your middle ear, through your inner ear, hence giving you a wrong result. To prevent that, you're going to occlude the external auditory canal by pushing your tragus in, or you can put a headphone or an earphone or anything that you will occlude the external auditory canal completely. Once you occlude the canal, you put a tuning fork onto the mastoid of the patient. So to perform this test, there are two prerequisites. The first prerequisite is the hearing sensitivity of the hearing sensitivity of the patient is compared with that of the examiner. Hence, the examiner's hearing should be normal. If I am doing the test and if I have a deaf ear, I cannot perform this test. So, this test is performed only if the hearing of the examiner is normal. Otherwise, you cannot do this test. The second prerequisite is you have to occlude the tragus. So, two prerequisites I've told you. Now, how we perform the test. So, assume that you are the patient. I vibrate the tuning fork. I place the tuning fork on your mastoid. I ask you to occlude your ear. And I will tell you to inform me when you have stopped to listen to the sound. And then when you tell me that you're not able to listen to the sound anymore, I transfer the tuning fork from your mastoid to my mastoid and I occlude my tragus also. So if you are not able to hear the sound and I am also not able to hear the sound when I have transferred it to my mastoid, it means that my hearing is equal to your hearing, which means that if I am normal, you're also normal. Did you get this? Okay. Now what happens if there is a sensory neural pathology? We know that bone conduction route measures only your SNP, the sensory neural pathway. So what happens when I vibrate a tuning fork and keep it on your mastoid and you occlude the tragus and then you say you have stopped to listen to the sound and I transfer the tuning fork from your mastoid to my mastoid and I also occlude the tragus. You said you have stopped to hear the sound, but when I put it onto my mastoid, I still continue to hear that sound. It means that you are hearing the tuning fork for a lesser duration of time than me, and which means that you have got which pathology? A sensory neural pathology, because we are testing your bone conduction. So what will be measured there? Only your sensory neural pathway route. So BC, absolute bone conduction test, normal is equal to that of examiner. Okay, and if it is shortened, meaning that you are able to listen for a shorter duration of time, it means that you have a sensory neural pathology or a sensory neural hearing loss. Is this understood? Absolute bone conduction test by all of you? If you have understood, please put a thumbs up or let me know in the comments if I have to repeat. If not, I will move ahead. Okay, so since there is a lag, by the time you give me answer, I will go to the next thing, which is your Schwaback's test. So in Schwaback's test, you compare, So in Schwaback's test, it is absolutely similar to your absolute bone conduction test. The only difference is the meatus is not occluded. So when you don't occlude the meatus, you are allowing the sound to travel even from your BC route, also from your AC route. Okay, so which is a sensitive test, an absolute bone conduction test or a Schwaback's test? Which is more sensitive in terms of identifying a sensory neural pathology? An absolute bone conduction test or a Schwaback's test? So which is a more sensitive test? So the same test is performed, but you do not occlude the meatus. So the most sensitive test is a Schwaback's test. Now the inference is the same. Normally you should be able to hear for the same duration of time as much as that of the examiner. Meaning when I put it on your mastoid, transfer it to my mastoid, both should be able to hear for the same duration of time. If it is shortened for you, then there will be a sensory neural hearing loss. But if it is lengthened, meaning you have some pathology that is causing you to hear for a longer duration of time as compared to that of an examiner, it means that you are having a conductive pathway problems. Yes. So sorry, the absolute bone conduction test is the more sensitive test. Fine. You people are right. I just got went into the flow of Schwaback and wrote it as Schwaback's test. So normal is equal for the examiner as well as the patient. It is shortened for sensory neural pathology, and it is lengthened whenever there is a conductive pathology. Okay, so I hope this finishes your Rinne, Weber, ABC and Schwaback's test. The next test is Bing's test and Jelly's test. Both principle is essentially the same. Whether it is the Bing's test or the Jelly's test, the principle is essentially the same. What do we do in Bing's test? In Bing's test, we are trying to open and close the canal. You're going to push the tragus in and occlude the canal or open the tragus and see. Whereas in a Jelly's test, we are going to use a Siegel's pneumatic speculum and we are trying to increase and decrease the pressure in the external auditory canal. You take a Siegel's speculum and with the cuff, you increase and decrease the pressure in the canal. So what happens whenever you're occluding the meatus? Okay, so when you're occluding the meatus or whenever you're increasing the pressure, you should be able to hear the sound that is given to you more louder. You all can perform this test at the moment with me. When I am talking to you, try to alternately open and close, open and close. You should be able to appreciate that change in intensity of sound. If you are not able to appreciate that change in intensity of sound, then it means that you have got some conductive pathology problem. Okay, the simplest way to understand this is try to alternately close and open. If you are not able to appreciate that change in intensity, the increase and decrease in the intensity of sound, that means that you are having a conductive pathology, especially in patients with otosclerosis or whenever there is a fixation of ossicle, we do this Bing's test and Jelly's test. So I hope you've understood what is a Bing's test, what is a Jelly's test. Okay, so Rinne, in conductive pathology, is it positive or is it negative? I will not fill this chart. I am giving you time. I will wait till the lag is getting covered here so that you can tell me what I have to fill in the chart given here. Yes, now that you are able to see the chart, can you tell me what is happening in Rinne for a conductive pathology? If there is a conductive hearing loss, Rinne should be positive or Rinne should be negative? Very good. So Rinne is negative. In sensory neural hearing loss, Rinne is, what happens to Rinne in sensory neural hearing loss? Yes, all of you are correct. Now, what happens to Rinne in sensory neural hearing loss? Yes, it is positive. Okay, then the next thing, what happens in Weber's in conductive hearing loss? Very good, all of you are answering it right. Now what happens if whenever there is a conductive hearing loss, where will the Weber get lateralized to? Towards the affected ear. Whereas in a sensory neural hearing loss, it goes to the opposite ear. Absolute bone conduction test has no inference in a conductive hearing loss, whereas it is shortened in a sensory neural hearing loss. Schwaback's test, it is lengthened in conductive hearing loss and it is shortened in sensory neural hearing loss. Okay, so this chart will tell you about all the four types of tuning fork test that we most commonly do. Now coming to another question that could be asked of late is tests for malingering, where you have got mainly two tests. There are many tuning fork tests for malingering, but the two main tests are Stenger's test and Chimani-Moose test. Okay, So for Stenger's test, what do you do? Normally, you give two tuning forks of the same frequencies apart kept from both the external auditory canals away. Okay. Normally, the patient should be able to hear well in the better ear. So assume that the patient is malingering, that he is not able to hear in the left ear. He can hear only in the right ear. Okay. So you keep tuning fork here of 512 hertz, tuning fork here of 512 hertz. He will tell that he can hear only from the right ear. He cannot hear from the left ear because he is deaf. Now, what do? I get this tuning fork closer to the right ear. He should be able to tell that he is able to hear. Normally, he will be able to hear the same. But what will he tell? Because you have got it closer, he will tell that he is hearing better in the right ear, unable to hear in the left ear. So, that test will tell you whether this patient is malingering or not. In a Chimani-Moose test, it is same like that of a Weber's test, but you will occlude the tragus. When you occlude the tragus, the patient should hear better onto the ear that is occluded because the ambient noise is not entering. But the patient will tell no change in the intensity of sound heard by the patient. So for these tests of malingering, you need to know the name rather than the principle, because they will ask you Stenger's test or Chimani-Moose test are tests for malingering. Okay, so we will go to the MCQs. The most sensitive tuning fork test is a Rinne's test, a Weber's test, an absolute bone conduction test, or a Schwaback's test. Yeah, I'm waiting for the answer. Which is the most sensitive tuning fork test? Is it a Rinne most sensitive, Weber's most sensitive, absolute bone conduction test most sensitive, or a Schwaback's test? See, the most sensitive tuning fork test is when will the result of a tuning fork test be positive or when it's going to be negative. So the most sensitive, yes, Hemant, you are correct. It is your Weber's test. So for a Rinne to become negative, Rinne positive is normal or sensory neural hearing loss. For Rinne to be negative, you need at least 15 to 20 decibels of hearing loss. Okay, so you will need 15 to 20 decibels of hearing loss for a patient to have Rinne negative. Whereas for a Weber's test, you will need only a 5 decibel hearing loss for a Weber to be negative. Now, absolute bone conduction test in comparison to Schwaback's test is a better test. But in absolute bone conduction test, you are measuring the hearing sensitivity of the patient with that of the examiner. So you are not comparing the patient's hearing of one ear with that of the other ear. So in Weber's test, we are seeing where the sound is getting lateralized towards which ear. So patient himself is the receptor there, and hence the most sensitive tuning fork amongst all these is a Weber's test. Threshold for bone conduction is normal and that of air conduction is increased in a disease of middle ear, inner ear, cochlear nerve, temporal nerve. So can you answer this? Threshold for bone conduction is normal and that of air conduction is increased in a disease of. I can give you hints if you want. They are telling you BC is normal, AC is affected. So where is BC normal? When does AC gets affected? For that you simply need to know the formula. AC is equal to CP plus SNP and BC is equal to SNP. So when will only AC be affected? Whenever you have got a conductive pathology problem. So where will you have a conductive pathology problem? Whenever you have got a disease of the middle ear. Okay, is this clear to all of you? A man presented with hearing loss. Rinne was positive on the left side, negative on the right side. On performing the Weber's test, the sound is localized to the left side. The diagnosis is So I will write it down for you. They have given you. So whenever they're giving you tuning fork test, try to make a chart and see what is happening. So they're giving you that Rinne is negative on the right, positive on the left. And they're telling Weber is not central. It is being localized towards the left side. So what is your answer? Is it a right conductive hearing loss, right severe sensorineural hearing loss, left severe left sensorineural hearing loss, and left conductive hearing loss? See, whenever they say right negative, left positive, so this can be either conductive hearing loss, this can either be normal or SN loss. Okay, now if Weber has to go to left, if the Weber has to go to left, either there should be a right SN hearing loss or either there should be a left conductive hearing loss. Correct. Now they are giving you completely opposite. So if right, there has to be a sensory neural hearing loss, Rinne should have been positive. If there were left conductive hearing loss, Rinne should have been negative on the left. So the answer here is, the right side, the Rinne is false negative. Why is Rinne false negative? Because there is a unilateral severe sensory neural hearing loss. So whenever there is a severe sensory neural hearing loss on one side, I will explain this principle to you very quickly. Okay, so if you assume this is the cochlea of one side, this is the cochlea of other side. Now, what is Rinne's test? You are comparing the air conduction with bone conduction. Now, why is it falsely negative? When you give a tuning fork, when you keep a tuning fork on the mastoid, if there is a sensory neural hearing loss, what should be better? Air conduction should be better than bone conduction. But this cochlea is severely damaged. Now, if it is severely damaged, the sounds are now going transcranially to the opposite cochlea. As a result, what is happening? BC is being perceived. Whereas, can the air conduction route travel through the cochlea because it is severely damaged? No. So, what is happening? AC is getting affected. So, BC is going through the opposite cochlea. So, BC is better than AC. So, that is why you are getting negative on a Rinne's test. It is not true negative. It is false negative. Seen whenever you have got a severe sensory neural hearing loss. Did you get this? So sound is getting transmitted through the bone to the opposite cochlea. So BC is being perceived by the patient, whereas the air conduction route sound cannot go through the cochlea because it has a severe component of hearing loss. As a result, BC is greater than AC, and this is called as Rinne negative. But is it truly negative? No, it is falsely negative. So Hemant, I think I've answered your question. What is Rinne's false negative? Yes. So the answer here is right severe sensory neural hearing loss. So once there is a right severe sensory neural hearing loss, the sounds will obviously go to the left side, and hence you have got the Weber on the left side. But right side, the Rinne is negative, not true negative, but it is a false negative. Yes, understood? Okay. Jelly's test is done for senile deafness, acoustic neuroma, otosclerosis, malingering. When do you do a Jelly's test? Simple thing, don't try to remember the principle of Bings and Jelly's. Simply remember opening and closing of the tragus. Are you able to appreciate that increase and decrease in the intensity of sound? If you are able to appreciate that change, it means that you're normal. If you're not able to appreciate that change, it means that you have which pathology? A conductive hearing loss, especially in patients with otosclerosis. Yes, you all are correct. Jelly's test is done for otosclerosis. So with this, I finish my class for today. And I remember Jyotsna asking me, when will I come with the class for throat? I have not finished my schedule for YouTube session at the moment, but I can tell you approximately when I can come online for that. 1 minute, just give me 1 minute, I will check. Okay, so 9th Jan morning, we have an audiometry class for the YouTube session. But I can try and adjust a few minutes more, about 10 to 15 minutes more, to help you understand throat. If you have a special requirement that you need to understand from the throat point of view, please put in the comment section below so that I will explain you only the thing that you are having a problem. If not, after that, on 16th, I have another class where I can take a half an hour session entirely dedicated for throat and its MCQs. Okay, so if you have liked my class, you can follow me on my special classes on an academy platform as well, where these classes are free for all the students. You can have access to so many of the questions, high yield topics and revisions. So you can follow me there. And if you want to subscribe through an academy platform, you can subscribe. You can use the code Vaishnavi.Jaji8219. And you can avail some good discounts for it. So if you have liked my class, please like, share, and try to follow me in my next classes as well. If you want something that you feel is difficult for you to understand, please put it in the comment section below so that next YouTube sessions I will do those classes which is difficult for you to understand, and then we will take it from there. So wish you all a very, very happy Sunday. And those preparing or giving the NEET exams, good luck. I'm sure all of you will do extremely well in your exams. And may God bless you all. Bye-bye.